yeah. If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light, give sight to the ones who've lost their way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. When your days down here through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on your sleeve, and if you're trying to be the change you wanna see, if you lay down your life for love so someone could be saved, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you.
Living shall not be in vain. McDonald.
If I can do my duty as a good man ought, if I can bring that beauty to a world abrupt, if I can spread love's message as the master taught, then my living shall not be in vain. Then my living shall not be in vain. Oh, my living shall not be in vain. As I pass along, then my living shall not be
in vain.
My living shall not be in vain.
No, my living shall not be in vain. As I pass alone, in my living shall not be
thank you.
Musician, could you stop playing for me for a moment, please? Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter days upon the earth, and I shall see God when I shall see for myself, and mine eyes shall behold, and not another. We brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord giveth, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. This morning we are giving God thanks for this privilege that we are here for this Thanksgiving service for Sister Betty Elizabeth Bernard. A woman has lived a life that we can be able to celebrate with her this morning in this Thanksgiving service. I want to say on behalf of the pastor, Pastor Phil Roy Houslin and his family, the committee members and all the members of this church, 58 Maxfield Avenue, and our pastor, Glendon Wallace, we want to extend our sincere condolences to the bereaved family. And I want you to know that we are praying for you and will continue to pray your strength in the Lord. At this time, I will hand over to Deacon Taff.
Praise God. Let me the church worship the Lord. Please be seated. I want to welcome you to 58 Maxfield, and we are here this morning to do what we usually do. Support, pray for you in your time of bereavement. At this time, we want to do the opening hymn, When Peace Like a River. I'm gonna ask, praise God. Are you hearing me? Praise God. Please, like a river. time, I call on Senior Deacon, Deacon Leonard Harrison, to do the opening prayer at this time.
Let's pray. Almighty God and our Heavenly Father, today we do thank you, dear blessed Jesus, for this another privilege that we all, blessed Savior, enter into your courts another day, O God. Jesus, we do thank you for your kindness, your great, tremendous mercies. Loving Father, as we come before your holy presence this morning, Lord, it's not so much a very happy time, but nevertheless, dear Jesus, you are here with us today. And Lord, I am asking thee at this time for your blessed mercies. Lord, I pray as we come together in this funeral procession, Lord, I pray that you lead and direct us in your own way. Loving Father, I pray today, O God, that our mind will rest upon thee, knowing that you are the same Savior yesterday, today, and forever. And Lord, as we come to celebrate, O God, the death of our sister, loving Father, we do thank you for taking us thus far. Loving Father, she do live a life in this present life, O God. She serve you in spirit and in truth. And because of that, this morning, we are now in the presence, O God, to celebrate this wonderful sister of ours. Father, I pray, O God, that thou will have your own way. Bless this service, O God. She's there laying in this casket. She will never hear what we've been saying. But those, O God, that have an ears to hear, let them hear, O God, and let them understand that this moment, O God, it is an example that we all will take and realize that one day, who is alive now is going to be like this a little later on down the road. I pray that you will set our heart at the place, O God, that our heart will please thee, and we will walk with you in the beauty of holiness. So, O God, you can use us as your own instrument. Remember today, O God, the bereaved family. I pray, O God, that you'll give them a heart of comfort, a heart of peace. Oh, Jesus, and let them realize that you are the only comforter. Lord, lead this service and direct it. And let everything be done today in the honor, to the honor and to your great glory. Lead on, O King Eternal, of thine own way. I pray you will snatch your people as a branch from the burning. And set us free and let us walk Christ-like. So in the end, Lord Jesus, it will be well with our soul. Bless us one and all. Be with us. Lead his service. And let everything be done to great honor and to your great glory. Have thine own way today, Lord, while I ask these mercies and tell you thanks. In Jesus' name.
Praise God, my senior deacon. I thank God for those coming in for safe journey here. At this time, we're going to do the first lesson, and the lesson will be read by Niece Sadiqa Bernard. Did I get that right? Sadiqa, okay, very well.
Testing one, two.
Good morning, church. Today's Bible reading is taken from Ecclesiastes 3, verses 1 to 15, the reading from the NIV version. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down, and a time to build, a time to weep, and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones, and a time to gather them, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search, and a time to give up, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to mend, a time to be silent, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. What do workers gain from their toil? I have seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet, no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there is nothing better for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is a gift of God. I know that everything God does will endure forever. Nothing can be added to it and nothing taken from it. God does it so that people will fear him. Whatever is has already been, and what will be has been before, and God will call the past to account. Here endeth the reading of God's holy word.
Praise God. At this time, we're going to take a selection from Kelly and Bernard. It's you. But we're going to do a tribute, and then we come back to her while she organizes herself. At this time, I invite Melissa. Melissa, you are here. All right. Marsha Lewis is here. Yes. Where's Melissa? Is here? Oh, not yet. All right. Okay, we're going to take a tribute from the FYC department. If you are a past FYC member, a present FYC member, we invite you at this time to take a tribute from the FYC department. Praise God.
Good morning, everyone. Praise the Lord. And so I think that it is fitting to share this song for our dear beloved sister Betty Bernard. And the reason why I'm going to share this song and playing, and I'm also going to be singing, because I believe that a midnight cry will be going. Ready.
Thank you, my deacon and Sister Meeks. Praise God. At the midnight cry, we'll be all going home. One of the things with Sister Bernard, we know and we trust that she will make it in with her Savior based on the life. None of us can see in God's book, but based on the life that she lived and the ministry of prayer that she endorsed. At this time, I'm gonna call Sister Joyce Darlington, a very close friend, will be doing the second lesson. Praise God.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Our second lesson is taken from 1 Corinthians 15, reading from verse 50 to 58. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither that corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put mortality. So when this incorruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Praise God. I thank God for those words from Sister Joyce. I want to make special mention of the family members overseas, those on the platform. We are praying with you. We are here giving thanks for the life that Sister Elizabeth Bernard has lived. And I want to, at this time, to extend greetings from some members of the congregation overseas and past members. Want to bring greetings and condolences from our past immediate pastor, Pastor Dr. Robert Jacobs in New York, from Deacon Tony Lawrence in Miami, Florida, Evangelist Lawrence. She extends greetings, Sister Sophia. All of those brethren, they are extending greetings. Pastor Chambers could not be here. He has his pastoral duty to do. And I am bringing greetings from all of these members. Pastor Walker, who is in Florida, who knows Sister Bernard from he was, you know, a young man. Pastor Wilson extend greetings of condolences. He could not be here at this time. At this time, we're going to ask a tribute from the men's ministry, and Evangelist Nash will be doing that. And we're going to take another tribute, after which we're going to adjust the program, and we're going to have the sermon becoming after the other tribute due to circumstances beyond our control. Sister Bernard was a very flexible person, and we want to operate same. This time I invite Evangelist Nash.
Good morning again to the viewers and all those who are here. On behalf of our pastor and family, I want to extend greetings to you all. Sister Bernard was a lovely, lovely sister. And you know, we don't like to scatter roses when the person is gone. We like to tell them, and we usually tell her how we love her. We usually tell her that she's a nice sister. She's quiet, soft-spoken. Anything about it, we love her. And she has lived a life. And I'm saying to the family member, don't mourn, because she's in a better place. And the Lord knows everything best. And I'm saying, brother, be strong in the Lord. We are praying for you all. And on behalf of the men's ministry, we want to extend our sincere condolences to the bereaved family. Be strong in the Lord. Blessings to you all.
Praise God. At this time, we are going to take a tribute from the women's ministry of our church. Madam President. Okay. The lot has been cast, and Sister MacDonald will be doing the same.
Bless the Lord, everyone. Bless the Lord. Elizabeth Betty Bernard. Elizabeth Betty Bernard's life was a blessing. Her memory a treasure. She was loved beyond words and missed beyond measure. We were happy to see her the day she stepped on the grounds of the Church of God Seventh Day at 58 Maxfield Avenue during the early years, 1970s. The late Pastor Gershom Wallin baptized her and gave her the right hand of fellowship to defend the church in moral principles and doctrines wherever she goes. This she did on many occasions, on the streets, on public transportations, and even in the house of God. Sister Betty, as she was affectionately called, loved the Lord and therefore became an ardent member of the prayer group headed by the late missionary Susan MacDonald. She was a prayer warrior and would go visiting the sick with the group, the prayer group, offering prayers on their behalf. The school and college students benefited greatly from her prayers. Due to the dedicated life of Sister Bernard to the Lord, he spared her life by telling her to do 7 days of fasting, as the house where she was living would be burned down. So she obeyed the voice of the Lord, and as soon as she left the house, it went down to the ground. The Lord is awesome. At some point in Sister Betty's life, a young man asked her for a hand in marriage. She sought the Lord, got a vision from him, which was unfavorable, and so the proposal was turned down. Like Mary, she sat at Jesus' feet and waited for the anointing. We want to say thanks to Sister Hall, who provided shelter for our sister while she was ailing with a stroke. She spent a few weeks in the Kingston Public Hospital. As soon as she got out, she was back with the prayer group. Sister Bernard spent her final years at the nursing home, where the Lord saw it fit to call her home. She kept the faith, ran the race, and is now resting, awaiting the glorious morning when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound. Rest well, my sister, rest well.
Praise God. We could write a book about Sister Bernard's life. At this time, I'm going to ask the choir, before the preacher comes, to make themselves ready. All right, so going to take the choir at this time, please. We're going to take the choir at this time. Before the preacher, and then we'll continue with the program. Praise God. Thank you.
And I heard a voice from heaven saying, write, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, said the Spirit, that they may rest from their labor, and their works do follow them. Ladies and gentlemen, we have gathered here this morning in Thanksgiving service to celebrate the life of our departed Sister Betty Bernard. What a sunrise on April 1, 1948, and our sunset came on March 14, 2024. I'd like, on behalf of my wife, to extend our sincere condolences to the family members and also to the church family as we come to grip with the reality that our sister is no longer here with us. And as we grieve, I want to encourage us not to grieve as those without hope, because we have hope beyond death. Amen? Let me pause to recognize our moderator, Deacon Toff, and the other officers who are on the platform, Evangelist Nash, Deacon Harrison. I'm seeing Deacon Meeks over there, and there's somebody at the back to my left, look like Pastor Houslin, the host minister. I want to recognize him and if his family, if they are here. The members, officers and members of this church, visitors, and most importantly, family members, let me extend welcome to you and also to those who are in cyberspace. I want to extend cordial welcome to you. I am aware that what I will say today will neither help or hinder the eternal destiny of Sister Bernard. Her eternal destiny is in the hands of a righteous God. I pause to share my own reflection of her. I remember Sister Bernard, as Shirley seasonized in our song, Tribute to Her Mother, I remember Mama in a good way. I remember her indeed as a woman who stand up for principles. I remember Sister Bernard preaching, and you were forced to listen. You were forced to examine yourself because she would be preaching on what is required for us as believers to maintain a Christian walk. Sister Bernard would be numbered among some other sisters of this church. When they are praying, you know you'd have a long time waiting. Sister Bernard may have not been considered great according to the world standard. No bridge is named after her or roads named after her, but by virtue of the life that she lived, she stands taller than all of these above mentioned. Amen. So today we want to, and I want to pay my final salute to our fallen hero. It's a fond salute to a great mother in Zion. It's a profoundly respectful salute to a woman whose whole life was lived in a consecrated way to the service of God. Amen. This is a question that I ask at all funerals that I partake in. What's the purpose of sermon or homily at a funeral service? What purpose is, sir? Because certainly Sister Bernard can't hear a thing, good or bad, that I'm going to say. But may I suggest three reasons for sermons at funeral services? Number one, to offer comfort to the bereaved. Secondly, to encourage the believers that death is not the end. And thirdly, to speak to those who only come to church when there is a funeral service. Either it's somebody's funeral service or there. And I know we're not seeing anybody looking from the outside, but there is a virus that they call ecclesiophobia. And it's a fear of church. Because although some will come to the on the compound, they will not come inside church. But if there are any on the outside who may be hearing my voice, I would just encourage you, if you had not make it right with God, don't wait until you're pulled here in a casket. come and make it right before it's too late. I would like to share one little thought with us, and that is, no matter how hard we prepare ourselves as human beings for that which is inevitable, for that which is inescapable, for that which is life's common denominator, and that is death, no amount of preparation can allow us hearing that one of our loved one is gone. Because you see, death was never a part of God's plan. Death is a result of a lie that is being continue to be spewed out of the mouth of the liar, the devil. You shall not surely die. But by virtue of the statistic I'm going to share with you, we're going to see how much that lie multiply and triple and all of that. Worldwide, there are approximately 56,600,000 deaths each year. That works out to be about 4.7 million per month. 155,000 per day, 650 per hour, 107 per minute, and 1.8 per second. Even as we are talking right now, somebody is taking their last breath. Death, my brothers and sisters, comes without regard for the young. Death comes without pity for the poor. Deaths come without regard for the age. And death come without consideration for the newly married. Death is inevitable. The first day we land on planet Earth, death took out its death book and wrote our names in a book and said, "It's just a little while and I will have you." My advice to all of us, let us try to do good for our loved ones when they're alive. Amen? But when they're dead, we can't do anything. And my brothers and sisters, man has been able to travel to the moon, sail through the air in plane, go deep in the ocean. Great advancement in technology. Great advancement in the medical field. Cure some types of cancer. Separate Siamese twins. Fertilize the egg of a woman outside of the womb and put it back in the womb. Man has been able to split atom. But all death keep on destroying. Man cannot find a cure, for death remain elusive. Amen. Death is irreversible. And to that end, there are persons who are practicing something they call chronics. That is deep freezing of the body immediately after they die in the hope that man will find down the road a cure for death. But the believers in Christ don't need to wait until technology find a cure for death. Because I know a man, praise be the name of the Lord, yes, who have already conquered death. Amen. Do you know him? Praise the name of the Lord. This man walk on water. Yes, yes. Turn same water into wine. Calm the raging storm with three words: peace, be still. Give sight to the blind. The man we are talking about is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And how do I know that? Amen. In the book of John 11, Bible tells us a certain man by the name of Lazarus was sick, called the master, didn't show up on time. When he eventually showed up, Lazarus was dead and buried. Sister said, "Master, if you were here, our brother would not have died." Jesus said, "I am." Hallelujah. The resurrection and life. "And in my present death, take flight. Because I am the resurrection and life. Show me where you lay him." They said, "Master, we know that he will come back in the resurrection, and by now he stinketh." Jesus said, "You show me where you lay him." Hallelujah. When he got there, he said, "Roll away this stone." He said, "Master, by now he stinketh." Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Jesus said, "You roll away the stone." And he called Lazarus. "He that was dead came forth from the grave." Dead people ought not to hear. Hallelujah. But when the voice of the master, hallelujah, Yes, call out, Lazarus, come forth. One of these days, my brothers and sisters, Sister Betty Bernard, will hear the call that Lazarus heard. Come forth. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord. Praise his holy name. Praise his holy name. Death for the believer is not a full stop. It is just a pause. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Atheist, an agnostic, teaches that when you're dead, you're dead. That is it. Nothing after death. But is that so? Well, from the Old to the New Testament, we are seeing the mentioning of the resurrection of the dead. Journey with me to the Old Testament. Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. He say, and many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to shame and everlasting contempt. Daniel, from way back in the Old Testament, testify, he prophesy of a day when those who sleep in the ground will come forth. Job, in Job chapter 14, he asks a question, if a man die, shall he live again? Amen. And Job said, all the days of my appointed time, I'm going to wait until my change come. Oh, praise the name of Jesus. Church of the living God, a change is coming. It is unstoppable. Death cannot prevent this change. One day, Sister Bernard will go through the process of a change. The mortal will put on immortality. And this corruption shall put on incorruption. A change is coming. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Praise be the name of the Lord. Paul, great apostle, confirmed this change. He said in 1 Corinthians 15 and the 51st verse, behold, I show you a mystery. Hallelujah. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed. Talk to me now, church. You believe it? In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise. We shall all rise to meet him. We shall all rise to meet him. Amen. But not only that, Jesus Christ himself, the resurrection and life, he said, verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of Man, and they shall live. If a man dies, shall he live again? Hallelujah. Amen. But watch this. Jesus not only talk the talk, he walk the talk. Amen. Because you see, he came to her to redeem fallen mankind. The Bible said everywhere he went, he was doing good. Healing the sick, giving sight to the blind, representing the marginalized and the forgotten and the downtrodden. Amen. But one day they lied on him. And they set up a kangaroo court and they found him guilty, although he was innocent. They buried him in a borrowed tomb. Amen. Amen. The realms of darkness celebrate the victory because we get rid of the troublemaker. Amen. Amen. Day one, they celebrate. But you know, I often said the clock keep ticking. Amen. And before his death, Jesus said, if you destroy this temple, I'll raise it up in 3 days' time. They thought he was making reference to the physical structure, not realizing that he was talking about himself. So day two, the realms of darkness celebrate. But the clock keep ticking. Praise be the name of the Lord. Amen. And at the appointed time on day three, an angel was dispatched from heaven with the speed of light. Roll away the stone. Amen. And he that was dead, somebody say, up, 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 up from the grave. He arose, church, and declared that I have the key, death, and the grave. When they went there, the angel said, why he seek the living among the dead? Hallelujah, he's not here. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Revelation confirmed and said, John on the Isle of Patmos said, and I saw a new heaven, and I saw a new earth. Amen. And then John saw the holy city coming down, and I heard a voice of heaven said, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. If you have to cry, go on and cry now. But a day is coming where there won't be any more tears, no more pain, no more sad party, no more casket. Amen. Funeral parlor is going to be out of service. No more hospital, no more suffering, no more separation, no more anguish, no more disappointment. Better days are coming, church of the living God. Praise the name of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. So as we anticipate that better day, we can only be a part of that better day if we live for Christ. Amen. And the opportunity to do so is now, because there is no repentance in the grave. Amen. And the songwriter said, we better get right with God. Come and do it now. Come and do it now. Salvation is being offered. Hallelujah. And I don't know if they are unsaved in the house, but I just want to do one more thing, one last thing. Normally at, is this pace down? Normally at wedding, they throw a bouquet, and the one who catches it, it is suspected that will be next in line to be married. So I am asking, if I just turn my back and throw this, would anybody be willing to catch it? Nobody willing to catch it? All right, well, I'm not offering bouquet. I'm offering Jesus. If you don't know him, come and know him now. Amen? He is the resurrection and life. And if you want to live and reign, if you want to see your loved ones who have passed on and die, they die in Christ, then make sure you make Jesus your choice. Amen? Praise the name of the Lord. May God allow us who have accepted the Lord to maintain a steadfast walk with him. Amen? Don't deviate. Don't turn to the left or to the right. Put on blinkers, because the enemy of our soul is seeking to rob us of our salvation. Maintain your steadfast walk. And those who are outside of Christ, my advice to you is to come and accept him now. It's a prayer in my heart. God bless you. God keep you. In Jesus' holy name.
Praise God. I thank you, Pastor Wallace. Pastor Wallace would have to leave to another funeral. Although I'm a stubborn guy, when the shutting, when the seniors tell me to do something, I have to do it. Sister Bernard requested E or Pastor Wilson to preach at her funeral. And I'm glad I ticked that off. So I adjust the program to allow him to go. Hope I didn't offend anybody. We have to be flexible. Praise God. God bless you. Thank you, Pastor Wallace. I thank you for that. Praise the name of Jesus. At this time, we're going to continue with our tributes. I want to welcome those who are coming in, those who are on the platform, and I thank you for listening. I'm going to ask Sister Salt, someone who grew with Sister Betty from a child, to speak at this time. Praise God.
From the Wallace family. So that's why she chose him. Praise the Lord. Because she knows that he's going to bless somebody's soul. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Let me tell you something. You know, we come from a country and we used to it. Hallelujah!
Siblings, you know, I hope you don't put on Christ because we we are nothing. Hallelujah. I said, without Christ, we are nothing. Praise God. Today, my cousin, Lord, many little things we got through. But here she are today. Me up far, me up come from Minos Engines. Me have become a Betty funeral. Me couldn't make it past me. Because we grow as one. Praise the Lord. Let us continue to live for Christ. Because we know we hear what the preacher said it well. Death is not the end. Praise the Lord. But we have after death, then comes the judgment. Praise the Lord. So let us get ourselves ready in Jesus' name.
Praise God. I see Sister Melissa, one who Sister Bernard had ministered and encouraged to come to the Lord. And I'm going to ask you to come at this time to give your tribute. Praise God. And while she comes, you know, these days when people minister to people, come to the Lord and just let them go. Sister Bernard monitored the mic over there. Monitored. Groom her in the best way possible. Melissa, take off your glasses and get a peep who you are, man. Yes, you all know her. Right, with the little boy. You remember her now? Very good. Lovely. Praise God.
When I was teaching at a school in Greater Park, and she came there to have devotion with the students. And when devotion was long, and she left, and I said, thank God she left, because it was so long, and I had the pen in my hand to mark the register. And she just stepped up. And when she stepped up, I started getting nervous, because I see her authority. And I said, the pen dropped out of my hand. And she said, the Lord sent me to pray with you. And the Lord said to tell you he loves you and he's able to carry you through. And I said, my God, you really love me. I've melted because for the entire week, person to me, I said, you're looking so beautiful. I said, thank you. But inside, I was dying. I was on the edge. And I knew it was God because I said, only God could know what I was feeling at the time. So when she said to me that the Lord said, you know, I knew it was true. And she took my number and I accepted Jesus immediately. When she left, she called me, and my hand was in my jaw like this. And she said, Melissa, read Psalm 121. I said, this man is normal. This man. So my hand told me, I think about everything, and I was pregnant, so I was messy. I was at the edge, and my family wanted to bury me like I was a class away. I said, God, and she called me, and she came across the screen. So one day I called her, and I said, where are you? And I said, where's your church? I said, Maxine. And I find the church and I came. I started attending the fasting. And then I started coming on a Sabbath and I baptized pregnant. And when she said, boy, you're not naked, you know, come, because I said, I don't have any dress. She said, come on, you're not naked. And she journeyed with me. You know, sometimes when I'm here, she just come and said, God, you give me this. I said, my God, I started to have an encounter. I started to see God in a different way. Because I said, she just, when I is money or anything, if it's food, she said, God, she said, I said, oh God, I started to look and I'm saying, God, I just give him thanks because my faith started to grow. So I want one particular day, you know, my time was up at that school. I was working. And I remember gas set me up. It's the first time I'm having that experience. Gas came up to my neck. And my son came to the room and he said, Mommy, my stomach. I said, I'm coming, baby, I'm working on something. I was on my knees and I was praying and I said, God, I'm not calling no sister and a brother and a body. I'm calling upon you, God. And when I look, my phone rings, Sister Bernard. She said, Melissa, you know, when I was at home, my phone, the Lord said, remember Melissa? And she said, God, I'm coming. I'm going to cook some rice. The Lord said, don't cook no rice. Put the yam and the banana. And when I was there, you know, same time, I hear knock, knock. It was JPS coming to disconnect my light. When I look, I hear the landlord come, and then I see the rain come. And I was looking through the window, I said, I don't think she's going to come again. What about 1 hour after that, I look. And I heard my phone ring. It was she. He said, Melissa, I'm at the end of the road. And I said, okay, I'm coming. I put on my boots and I run to the end of the road. And I saw her with a crocus bag. And I started to cry. I said, Sister Bernard, I can't manage this Christian journey. It's rough. She said, Melissa, you know, today I was there and the Lord said, remember Melissa. And when she started to share, oh, God said, remember me. And she said, I told her that everything done at the house. And she said, no, worry yourself because God love you. And she came up with me, came to the house, and she carried out peppermint. I said, my God, I started to see God in a different way again. Because I said, the God knows that guest take me up now and carry cook food. Cook yam and banana and peppermint. I said, my God, my face started to grow now. So I said, my God, she came and she started to join. And I said, she's such an angel on the earth. Because I said, no, man, I never seen this. Because in the world I've seen, you have to hustle and bustle. And when I look God, I said, carry mint for your stomach. So my son was there and same time and drink tea and we eat and drink. It's not like one banana, two bananas. No. She carry a meal. And we drink tea so till the gas gone. And I said, my God, you are so good. So when she called, she told me again now that the Lord said I shouldn't relocate it. So I said, oh my God, I'm going to miss you. She sent me off. She communicated. At one point, I lost the contact. And then I went on Facebook and I got the contact. And I started talking and she encouraged my spirit. We talk for hours, hours. I'm happy that I get the chance to talk to her and tell her how much I love and appreciated her. And that I said to her that I know of a ministry because of the experience that I have with the gas. Sometimes I go out on the market, go preach and tell people, oh, God good. I said to them, so this lady come and carry a mint. When I went to my community and I preached and I tell them, say, look here, God is so real. This man with the ganja behind his ears, he just take off the ganja same time and he said, come. And he just hold up his hand and surrender and accept Jesus. Because I was telling him, oh God, gonna send this lady come. I went again and I started ministering to this person. He said, make me take off the grub and the ganja. And then take it off and start and just accept Jesus. I said, God is so real. Because when they're looking at it and I say, my God, God is good. And I was happy that I get the chance to stay to her. And she said, praise God, Melissa. To God be the glory. So when I tell her, she said, to God be the glory, Melissa. Great things. She's happy. I said, even feeding ministry, I'm a part of this ministry, feeding program. He said, yes, now take me up again. So because I have that understanding, I go around in the comments and I assist as best as I can. Because I said, because of the experience that I had, I use it to encourage people. And I said, there's a God that understands, that knows everything that you're going through. Amen? Amen? God is good and I want to give God thanks for the life of this woman of God. Oh, she journeyed with me.
Praise
Hallelujah.
God.
God be the glory, great things he has done. God bless you, people of God.
Hallelujah. With such a testimony, praise God. This deserves a song of meditation. Oh my God. This is Sister Bernard's pretty niece.
God is good.
Praise God.
God is good. And all the time, God is good.
The things you're going through.
listen to. He's the God of the sun, the stars, the sea, and he is your father. He'll calm the storm and he'll find a way to fix it for you.
Respectful. I don't get along with people who are not respectful. I really don't get along. And she's very grateful. I remember one time I get some things from foreign and I put a nice bag to give her, but I was downtown. And I want to thank the caregivers over there. When I pop up, they would receive me and they were respectful and they let me in. The two caregivers, wave your hands, wave your hands, wave your hands. Praise God. Praise God. And as a result of that, I stopped at the shop and said, what am I going to get? Because I leave all the nice things way in Old Harbor. And I remember as I bought the things, people have to talk about God tell a thing, but as I bought the things, it's like something telling me what to buy. That's just the truth. I remember I bought Protex, I bought coffee, I bought Swiss milk with the milk. You can just throw it in the cup. I bought sardine and I bought crackers. And I don't know why I buy Destroyer. And when Sister Bernard opened the box, Sister Bernard said, Deacon, I was praying to God for Protex because it have antiseptic in it. That's you understand what she's saying? because it's a public space. The place down there is very clean, but she want to make sure. She said they feed her good and fit. Deacon, them take care of me too good. Them feed me too early. When them feed me 3 o'clock at night, come and want something, I can't get one of the sardines and the crackers. I said, Sister Bernard, I don't know if you must drink coffee. She said, doctor can't tell her what to drink. God provide. So I brought the Swiss milk and the coffee, the Nescafe, and she, you know, and I'm like, when she saw the destroyer, she said, Jesus, everything she said she prayed for, I bought. When I am worrying about the Irish Spring and the forest, the dove, she knew what she want, and God made me get what I, trust me. So from that, no, me no care no more Irish Spring. Protest. You know, she is grateful. And I'm telling you a secret about me, I don't like ungrateful people. So you learn that secret out, and she's respect. When I take long for come, she said, Deacon, I know you have school. She understand. She not diss me. Even when, and God provided, the thing about it is, when war, I did not know sometime, and God protected me. I saw my students, I saw the people that I grew up with. It's around there, so I grew up. I go right, Wellington Basic School, my girl. Me used to go over Lazarus with a free drink after school. So God made me know the place, and God provided me for her. You know, Sister Bernard is such a nice person. Right now, I had a bag. I had a female bag. Tape up, I was not supposed to open it. And I was going to drop it off from a senior person who gave me to give Sister Bernard. By the time I go there, she was no more. I will just give that back to the women's ministry. They will know what to do with it. Sometime I'd be here at Sabbath school, and I would just leave and run, go down there. And she always want her money. One day I came to fasting on a Monday. I spent 1 hour, and I run, go down there, and I got some tangerine. And I said, Sister Bernard, only to me have some tangerine. She said, Deacon, give me. Lorraine took me to the market, and we could only buy 2 tangerine. Everything me give the lady, she grateful. Everything. And she said, Deacon, and I gave her $2,000. She said, may I try? I want Lorraine come this week. I want to go back for the tangerine money. And although she was humble, no food was unimportant, was there for her. I am a young deacon. Sometimes I feel like I would stop, but because of Sister Bernard, I would continue. And not because she's who she is, don't rule her. Though she tell you what she want. She tell you, say she don't want a large supper. I asked her if she would come to church. She said, no, deacon, the noise. She tell you what she want. I am so blessed that I have met Sister Bernard. That's it. Anybody like to say anything, and we be on our way to collect the offering. All right, let us collect the offering at this time. And I thank all the persons who gave tributes and their song. And I'm seeing persons from the community. And I'm sure you want to say something when we collect the offering, right, caregiver? Okay. All right. We're going to collect the offering. Sister Nadine, can you help me with this song, please? I'm asking you. Oh, Lord, my God. Please, when I in awesome wonder, come. Praise God.
Special way. Help us that as we use it further unto the unto your gospel. We pray and tell you thanks in Jesus' name.
All right, Miss, please come. And then Sir Milton will get ready.
Good evening, church. I will just sing this song. The song that I'm singing is for those that are unsaved. Others, listen. Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. For it was grace that bought my liberty. I never know just why Christ came to love me so. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. I shall forever lift my eyes to Calvary to view the cross where Jesus died for me. Grace that bought my falling soul. He looked beyond my fault and saw my need. Thank you very much. I don't have much to say, but all that has been said, she's such a wonderful
yes,
lady.
All right.
And I am one of them that she chose to do her hair on, take her to the post office. And as you mentioned about sardine, mackerel, and those things is what she love, and Alaska. So yes, everything that has been said, yeah, I know is she. Nothing false. Thank you.
Praise God. It can go so. Thank you very much.
Church, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, my family over there. Firstly, I would just like to say that my being here is really a testimony that God is certainly and is still in the miracle working business. I'd just like to share something with you, but let me do the right thing and observe protocols.
Yes.
To the members of the clergy, Pastor Philroy Houslin, the members of the platform, members on the platform, and to Deacon Taft. Church, let me tell you something, I want to take care of that man. Deacon Taft has been a beacon of strength. Believe me, I have never, ever in the longest while see a young person who has such a passion for the elderly. So take very, very good care of him. Let me share something with you. I started out by saying that God is certainly in the miracle working business. Yesterday, my spouse and I were been fighting a fire up where we are. From 3 p.m. yesterday up into 3 a.m. this morning. You might see me, I'm burnt all over here in my ears. there is a hillside fire, and almost the entire community was engulfed in flames. Part of my house got burnt up, burnt off. But we're still here. We're still here. And it's only a miracle why I'm standing here before you today. So I'd like to say thanks and praise to the Almighty, because it is only He who could have done that. I joked this morning with one of my siblings, and my niece, I think, in fact, and I said to her, listen, I wonder if we can postpone the funeral. And you ever hear of anybody postponing funerals? And she laughed. And say, postpone it until when? I said, me don't know, probably indefinitely, but me can't have Betty my eyes so long. So we are here. I'd like to say thanks to the church for giving us the privilege to host this service. And there are many of you who came on, I think it was Tuesday. Many persons came on Tuesday. And I must say, on behalf of my siblings and the other members of the family, our hearts were indeed warmed and touched by all the glowing tributes that we hear about Betty. We know her from that angle, but we also knew her from a different perspective as well. And what I'm going to be doing today is to do a sort of eulogy, remembrance kind of a thing. And I've oftentimes struggled at funerals to determine as to what really is the difference between the eulogy and the remembrance. I really don't know. I really don't know if there's a difference, but I normally see them stated differently on a program. So I'm thanking you, church, for the opportunity to be able to say my piece to you. Betty was born on 1st of April 1948 to her parents Enos and Imogene Bernard. And let me tell you something about eulogies. A lot of times we attend funerals. And I know when I attend funerals with friends, they are always excited when it comes around to the eulogy. People want to know historical date and background and all of them things for whatever reason. And so I'm going to give you a little piece, a little insight to satisfy the curiosities. Right. But Betty was born to my parents, Imogene and Enos, and she had, including myself, there were 8 children: Pauline, Jean, Colleen, who is now deceased, Barbara, Tessa Marie, Desmond, and myself. 2 boys. Betty attended the Niagara Primary, and Sylvia can bear me out if that was the name. Yeah. Betty attended Niagara Primary, and then when she came into town, into Kingston, my father enrolled her into what then was a prep school, that was Peterkin Prep. She did several years at Peterkin Prep. Then she went on to Fitzhenley Commercial College, and there was another school within Fitzhenley that specialized in telegraphy, telephony, that kind of a thing, and she went there. On Tuesday night, when we were listening to the service, many persons came out and they were witnessing as to how bright Betty was. And let me tell you something, she was in fact a very, very bright person. As my sister spoke the other night too on Tuesday, that it was Betty who taught her O-level math. Betty is my sister. Her English was always perfect, impeccable. She had a wonderful command of the English language. And I can probably attribute that to my mother in particular, because if we were playing outside and if Mama Rado spoke one piece of broken language, she would call us into the house, sit down there, you're not going out, you must speak properly. And so she embedded that in us, right? You had to speak properly. And I think Betty, more than any one of us, adopted that And I'm telling you, as I sit here, I've never heard her in any kind of a discussion, and her language was broken. Always on point. She worked at a couple of places. She worked, from my recollection, and I'm going to tell you something about the janitorial services. She was with a janitorial service. She worked, not many persons knew this, she was in charge, or she worked in telegraphy at Jamintel. Is there anyone here who remember Jamintel? She worked at Jamintel for a number of years. But Betty was a very stubborn, I don't hear much person saying it. Once her mind was made up that this is what she's going to do and this is what she wanted, you couldn't get her to change. And I'll share a couple of experiences that we have had with her, and that my one of my siblings was recalling, and we all laughed about it. Because, and I'll tell you why, although we grew up in the church, siblings and myself, but at that time we were not as firm. You know, young people, you are in the church, you see your parents going to church, and you just got to church. We were not as firm as we should have. But Betty was always a devout Christian, and in her young adulthood years, she lived in Franklin Town. And she had a couple of the worldly and material possessions, as we would call them today. So one day, my other sister, Jean, saw her. And Betty was so excited. And Betty says, "Jean, everything that I have, I'm going to give away." So Jean said, when you give them away, what are you going to do? And Betty, in her quiet, humble way, started laughing. And Jean says, "No, seriously, you are going to give away a fridge, stove, bed, everything. What are you going to do? You're giving up your house. Where are you going?" And she says, "Listen, God will take care of me. I'm going to evangelize." And she gave up every single thing. And she started going to preach on the buses. She would preach on the road. And I sometimes, and I'm telling you, I saw her sometimes on the road preaching. And of course, as a young person, you see your sister out there on the road preaching, sometimes you don't even want to talk to her, because she was so fervent in what she was doing. But as I have often said, and I've said it to my siblings, my other siblings, that somehow Betty and I had a very, very close relationship. We were very close. I think, and the siblings can probably bear me out, I think of probably all the siblings, she would speak with me the most. Perhaps, I don't know why, but we could always talk. I took her as I saw her. And I can tell you too that among us, me and the siblings, we were kind of upset. And I'm saying it, I'm speaking from my heart. We were upset when we saw Betty going down a particular part, because we thought that she, with the way she was bright, we thought that she should have gone in another direction. What a number of persons don't know is that she was offered, she was given a scholarship by one of my aunt and another institution overseas. She should have gone away to study nursing as one of the heiress. And 2 weeks before she was expected to take that flight to go overseas, Betty turned up at the house one day and said, "Listen, I am not going." And we said, "But all the plans have already been made." She says, "I don't care. I'm not going." I was upset with her for many, many months, because I couldn't understand why she wouldn't want to go. So too my other sisters. But that was the nature of Betty. She didn't care much about material things. She didn't care much about going to higher levels of education. I can tell you she was a fervent believer in God and her church and in evangelizing. When she checked into the home, she called me to say that she has checked in herself into our home. And I said, but Betty, because for years we've been asking her, we have a family house. I said, Betty, but we have been telling you or asking you to come to stay in the house, all expenses paid. She wouldn't have to do anything. And she says, no, she not. She won't take it up. I hope when I book her up in eternity, she can explain to me why. Because to this day, I still don't understand why Betty wouldn't want to go to the family house. It would be she alone and another sister. And like I said, everything was paid for. And a lot of persons don't know this, but that was in nature. That was how she was. She believed in evangelism. She was fiercely protective of herself and my brother because we are the only two here. Oftentimes we would say to her, Betty, we're coming to visit you. And she would beg us not to come. She said, no, don't come where I am. She said, don't come. And so I would meet her sometimes. Sometimes I would drive down. We'd arrange, pre-arrange spots, and I would go there. And I would share whatever it is that I had to share with her. But I still could not understand why she didn't want us to come. I think Desmond, my brother, has been here, has been right here to the church. And a couple of times she said, no, don't come. Come meet me at the church. And Desmond has met her a couple of times out here. She was that, I don't know if it's, well, she was fiercely protective. She didn't want us to come where she was, and that made us kind of despondent. And I'm saying all of this because sometimes, you know, funerals bring out the worst and the best in some of us. And I've heard it being said that Betty had family that turned their backs on her. Let me just put that to rest. This is not so. Betty chose her life, and we as family members were here. See, my cousin can verify, because she knows how close we all are. And we tried everything. But the truth is, to be helped, you have got to present yourself to be helped. And she knew exactly what she want. We have basically grown to respect her opinion and what she wanted. We just said, listen, that is what you want, that is what you want. And we supported her as best as we can. I know that she thought a lot about her church family, because on several occasions, she tell me about church. Even invited me to come a couple of times. And as you know her, she was always saying, come to church, come do this, come do that. There are going to be the naysayers, and persons will say anything and everything. But I'm just saying, sometimes in the absence of the facts, and if you can't say anything that is good, keep your mouths closed. Because I can tell you there are some things which impacted her in an adverse way, and she would mention them to me. She had very high praises for the home that she was in. I think it was Patricia Pierce, yes. Wonderful lady to her. I think you came once with her when we were meeting out by, yeah. When I came over, you took her over so I could see her in that plaza up there. But we loved our sister. I want to share one more with you before I go. She loved to evangelize. She was very protective. I said that already. I have a sister who was an officer at Jamaica Citizens Bank. And one day while she was there working in her office after work hours, she heard a voice outside. And she says to her staff, but that sounds like my sister Betty, man. Give me a minute. And she went outside, and there was Betty. She was with the janitorial services at the time. And Jean, of course, being an officer at the bank, she said, Betty, what are you doing here? What are you doing? She said, well, I work with the janitorial company. Jean says to her, all right. But you know, I can get you a job here. Come to me. I think it was a Friday evening or thereabout. Jean says, come to me, we do up the application and your job is secured. And of course, Jean felt quite happy. Betty looked at her straight up. Listen, I don't want any bank work. I will continue to do what I am doing. So Jean says, why? She says, I don't want distress. I don't want to be there. I will continue with the janitorial services. But that, I'm just showing you, that was her. Things of that nature did not bother her. On one occasion, I met her in Papine. And we were talking about life, we were talking about being secured. And she says, Mr. Betty, how is your housing situation? Because I always mention that whenever I see her, because I was trying to convince her to go down to the house to live. And I said, how is your housing situation, Betty? And she started laughing. She said, you know about a house? I'm so good, I started feeling happy now. So I said, what you want for the house and so on? What can I do? And she laughed. And she said, brother, you don't have to do nothing for me and that house. I said, what? She said, I no longer have it. And then she started laughing. I said, what is it? I started getting antsy. Why are you laughing? What's so funny? She said, well, I own the house. I stayed in that house for only 2 days. I said, well, she said a long story. And I won't tell you what had transpired, but she walked away from that house that she purchased. So when I said to her, come, I am going to get back your money. We are going to get back that money that you spent. Again, she said, brother, no, leave it alone. Let it stay there. I will survive. God will take care of me. So ladies and gentlemen, that's just giving you a little insight into Betty and her life. Thanks for giving me this opportunity to share with you. Hope you will know of a better understanding of what Betty is or was. We loved her dearly. And I'm just saying this to you openly as a church, as persons in the faith. Because sometimes our mouths, and I'm not preaching a service, you know, sometimes we say things and it can have an adverse impact on individuals and also on those persons who might be associated with them. So we have got to be careful how we walk and how we talk with people. One love, blessings.
Praise God. Praise God. Yes. We're done. We're finished. And but Sister Jenny and Brother Jelani will be bringing the curtain down. Sister Jenny is very... He's here, Sister Jenny? No, it's okay. Sister Jenny is very close to Sister Bernard. Sister Bernard would stay here all night and pray for anybody who had problems, who had situations. And Sister Bernard was very kind to Sister Jenny. But Sister Jenny will tell you in her own way. Sister Melissa forget to say to the church, her little boy and the baby that she have is now in the American Army. Come and say it yourself. This young girl, when she came and everything was going wrong, Sister Bernard hold her head together. You say it yourself, since you're waiting on Jelani. Say it yourself.
About 6 there about, and as I said, they hold me in their arms because I didn't understand. My mother died, so they were like a parent to me. So my son was up small, so now he has both of them has migrated. So the bigger one is now in the US Navy, and they send him to Japan. So now he's in Japan. So when I go around and I share my testimony, I encourage persons just to hold on to God because there's nothing hard for him. So we pushed as a single mother. Didn't know any way out. As I said, the gas take me up and reach up to my neck. Then when the devil said, I'm going to make the gas kill you, he said, me and my knees working on something. And I proved God showed up. My son at the time said, my stomach, mommy, but he didn't understand, say, I gas. So I said, I gas, man. I said, I'm coming, baby, I'm working on something. And I did praying and the Lord sent her to come. And as I said, now they are migrated and he's serving in the U.S. Navy and they sent him away to Japan to work. So God is amazing. Amen? God is good.
Yes.
God bless you.
We thank Sister Bernard for the life that she lived and the contribution. Also, Sister Bernard is, we're just waiting on Jillian is coming. Sister Bernard is also thankful for the caregivers. She made several assertions, said, why Deacon, them take care of me too much. Every minute the people them take my blood pressure. You know, every minute. And when we went there, she looked very clean. Her skin, her teeth, her hair. You could see the love. She looked very, and I was very pleased. You know, I was very pleased. So Jelani, I see him coming right in the church. And when a young man want to talk about an aged woman, you have to have respect. So he's here. So we're going to finish up after this. Sister Jenny, you're next.
Hallelujah. 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 I'm so grateful for this privilege. Sister Betty and I were mother and daughter. She was my mother. When I used to visit her where she lived, they would shout, Miss B, your daughter, come. Because we bonded in 2006 when I had to be coming to fasting service on Mondays. I had to. And before I go further, I want to tell you this. On the 16th of March, Sabbath, we were studying. Is it the 16th of March? Let me get my facts together. We were studying the Lord's Supper. We were studying the quarterly, the lesson. My prayer partner and I, Doreen Grosset, we were studying the Sabbath school lesson. And we were studying about God bottling up our prayers in censers. And when the prayers were bottled up, the angel went for it and poured incense on the prayers. And they were offered on golden altars. And said, Sister Doreen started saying, Lord, thank you for bottling up my prayers. And she said, thank you for bottling up Sister Jenny's prayers. And then she just said, Lord, we worship you for bottling up Sister Betty Bernard's prayers. And we started worshiping the Lord. And then she just became further inspired. And she said, Lord, seal Sister Betty. Lord, seal Sister Betty. And when we came out of that study, my son Jelani sent me a message to say, Mommy, have you heard? I said, heard what? Sister Betty has passed. I'm like, no. I went back on the phone and I said, Doreen, I just heard that Sister Betty has passed. But I believe at that time we were celebrating her triumphal transition. I believe we were celebrating without knowing that she had passed. We were celebrating who we knew she was. I would be at home sleeping because I used to have, or I became her assigned chauffeur. So many times, Melissa, I would take her to your house, right? Melissa? Many times I was her transport to your house. Yes. Just to substantiate that this was just who she was. She would hear a word from the Lord. For example, when the Lord said, go and conduct devotion at the school, she said, me, Lord. And the Lord would say, yes, I want you to go and conduct devotion at the school. And she would say, Lord, if this is you, let the dog come around here and turn over, roll over. She fleeced him. She wanted to be sure. And the dog came and rolled over. And so she knew she should go to the school. And at Whitfield School, they celebrated her. She was that profound. home sleeping. In the night, minutes to 12, I'm sleeping. And she would call and say, Sister Jenny, the Lord said, you must get out of that house. Get out of that house right now. Get into the house of the Lord. At that time, I was driving a Toyota Prado. How do I drive a Toyota Prado? Come down to Maxfield Avenue, park it outside, and it's only two females going to be inside. And so I was concerned about the safety of that. But then because the Lord said, I got out of the house and I came. And we prayed and we spoke in tongues and we travailed for most of the night. And in the morning, my sister called me. And she said, Jenny, where were you last night? I said, why? She said, Peter, don't be coming to my yard, come ask for you. Even Whitney Houston. Why did Sister Betty call me out of my house? There was a day we were by Spanish Town, first Sunday fasting, and she was walking around. She was saying, death, death, death. And by the time she was finished, this young man ran inside the church. And we were like, what? And there was a group of men running him down. And the guy, we said, you can't run in the church like him. He said, no, no, let me out. They're going to kill me. That was just soon after she finished prophesying. But then she would have prophesied death here also. Death, death, and people would have scoffed at her. But I tell you, Saul's death was prophesied 20 years before he died. Before he died physically. I live to see people die spiritually over the years since she has been prophesying death. The Lord used that woman. And I'm telling you, brethren, that when I think about her, we were so close, mother and daughter. And there were times when it was so bad with her. And she told me about her family. I'm not one of them who would, because she told me. It was her choice. How she lived, it was her choice. And she was sure to tell me that. And she, because she was surrendered, she, whenever I was out with her, I used to stand back a little because she had to go and tell somebody. Every soul was important to Sister Betty. Even when they were saying, like they don't want to listen to her, she just said, the Lord bless you. And if I use word to her, oh, Sister Betty, you're so beautiful. You're such a lovely person. She said, I don't use words like that to describe myself. I said, well, let me do. You are beautiful. You are wonderful. And she would just say, like Sister Betty herself, look at that. That's just her. And I think she was misunderstood. Well, misunderstood, but when I think about her, I think about what he said in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 36. And some had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned, they were sawn asunder, were tempted, were slain with swords. They wandered about, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. God having provided some better things for them. Hallelujah. 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 I celebrate Sister Betty's memory. I cried because I was hoping we would have gotten past this phase together. I was hoping that the day would come when we would celebrate the victory together. But she's gone to rest before me. And I worship God for what she taught me. If today I don't see the importance of soul, it's on me. If she taught me nothing else, she said, Sister Jenny, when you go into a public place, if you're not going to tell them about the Lord, sit down and pray. Pray for them. They are souls. They need to be saved. You must see, be beyond what they look like, see the need for the salvation of their souls. And so I pray that I will remain an evangelist. I pray that I will see the importance of soul. Sister Betty used to love when Jelani and I sang. She glowed. I just love when I sing. And she would smile. So I know this is our body, but I don't know if she will be able to look over the balcony of heaven and hear Jelani and I do this tribute. This is a song that, do you have a pick-me-up song? A song that picks you up?
Just it.
It was one of the songs that would pick me up. And my son and I used to minister it sometimes. He's now married and gone.
So, but there's not a king with more splendor than them.
Consider the sparrows, they don't plant or sow. Instead, they have a master who watches them grow. We have a heavenly Father above, eyes full of mercy, a heart.
Betty and I became porcupines with each other. There was a stage in our friendship when we couldn't go around each other. That's why you don't know me at the home. When I went around, I started having faint spells. I started having dizzy spells. I said, Sister Betty, I'm fainting. And she said, Sister Jenny, this is nefarious. Those were words she used. She said, these are nefarious plots to separate us. And she said, let us stay away from each other. That's how we will survive. So I hope that we would have gotten past it. And we would be back together. Oh, may I introduce you to this friend of mine. Each morning.
God, we're at the end. One last thank you from Sir Milton.
Thanks generally to everybody for attending. But I'd also like to now say a special, special thank you to my cousin Lorraine. She has been, I know that a couple of you might know her, she has been a tower of strength to us throughout this year. She has been here throughout everything. And I just want to publicly acknowledge her. Lord, we love her.
Yes. Yeah, this is Lorraine. This is Sister Robinson's daughter, right? Yes. All right, lovely. Sit. All right, at this time, we're going to close with the hymn, Mine Eyes Have Seen the Glory of the Coming of the Lord. And we're going to sing it like we're military, up and about, lively. Yes. Stand everywhere. Yes.
He's trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He has loosed the faithful line of his turbulence. His truth is marching on.
Almighty God and our Heavenly Father,
loving shepherd of all mankind. Savior, today we do thank you again for this another wonderful privilege. It is a privilege to thee, O God, to come to thee in prayer. You ask man to pray and not to faint. And this is why we come to you, O God, in prayer. At this time, O Father, we do thank you to lead this service to be a success. Loving Father, at this time, O God, I place the bereaved family before your presence at this time. Lord, if they mourn, let them mourn for happiness. Because, O loving Father, they're their sister that depart. Of a sure, O God, I can say this one. Lord, I have the assurance that she make it to your kingdom. And in the first resurrection, by your grace and mercy, she will arise. So I'm asking the bereaved family, rejoice in the Lord. Be happy, because this year, dear relatives, she make it to God's kingdom. And in the end of her life, of a sure we can say she live a life of righteousness. Lord, I continue to ask you that you will bless each and all of us that's in the presence today and lead us through the course of the day. And as she should remove from this assembly, O God, for our last time, going to our home of rest, I pray, O God, that they will lead the way to the cemetery and back away the powers of darkness and lead your people safely, O God, to this destination. Lord, have thine own way. Jesus, I pray that you'll sanctify our thoughts, O God, and continue to lead us in the path of righteousness for your name's sake. Thank you, O God, for how you lead this service through the course of today. Hear my prayer to you, O God. Lead on, O King Eternal. Have thine own way. Jesus, hear my prayer to you today. I pray, O God, that you will go with us. In Jesus' name, I ask these mercies and tell you thanks. In Jesus' name.
Praise God. Just before we do the last chorus, there are refreshments provided around the back. We'd want to take a 45 minutes, half an hour to half same, and be on our way. All right, please. All right, so we're going to do the last verse or whichever Sister Jenny choose, and the platform party would lead out. Then the gentlemen will come, and then the family, and then they say, it's out of respect, nobody move. Just follow the order that we are asking. All right? Go ahead, Sister Singers.
Someday